once in 25 years at Roma. So will the Viola end that poor run today? Let's get into the action with match commentators Don Howe and first, Peter Bradley.
Well, ironically, Roma, normally so strong at home, have been more consistent than away from the Olympic Stadium. And Fiorentina will take extra encouragement, too, from the absence in the Roma side today of two regular defenders, Carbone and Lana. And Noni has a marking role alongside the Brazilian Aldair. In midfield, Sweden's Jonas Tern is having a profitable run in the side at the moment. And up front, Fiorentina will have to contend with the striking prowess of the two South Americans, Balbo and Fonseca. The team from France are certainly less charitable defensively this season. Padolino, Amoruso and Serena all featured strongly in the 2-2 draw with Milan. And they've an excellent goalkeeper too in the giant Toldo. Schwarz, Rui Costa and of course Batistuta formed the overseas contingent in this lineup. Baiano is in fine form up front alongside Batistuta. So off we go then. Roma and the darker strip attacking the goal to our right, and this is Daniel Fonseca, the Uruguayan international, and that's the first free kick, the first foul of the game. This afternoon's referee is Robert Anthony Boggi from Salerno. Fonseca. Here is Rui Costa seeking out the run of Batistuta, and Trevone had come a long way out of his goal. Now the flag is up for offside against Fonseca. An explosive atmosphere around the stadium. A really big match then for these two teams. Hoping to have a serious tilt at the title. Rui Costa. Cheekily away from Totti, but Roma back in possession. Not for long though. Here's Piacentini, the former Roma player. He's in fact still half owned by the club. So he's had this one circled on the calendar for some time. 6 years Piacentini had with Roma. Fonseca being hustled there by Serena, who did such a fine marking job on Roberto Baggio in the recent game with Milan. Totti, chance to cross it in. Jonas Tern, Aldair, two of the former Benfica players on the pitch today. Tern, Rui Costa, Schwarz and Aldair. Here's Petruzzi, the sweeper in the Roma team. Aldair lending his weight to this attacking sortie. Good interception. And the shot well charged down. Annoni. Fiorentina, remember, haven't won this fixture, or have in fact won it only once in 25 years. 4 years ago when Batistuta got a couple of goals for them in a 3-1 win.
Well, it's a good start for Roma. I mean, they've gone on the attack straight away, Peter, and they've got Fiorentina pinned in their own half. And obviously, they're very tight on Fonseca, you know, he likes to work the flanks. He'll go right flank, he'll go left flank. But the straight away people are closing him down. They know he's got the ability to create something from that wide position.
Little problem there for Rui Costa, but I think he's going to run off the injury. Statuto. Balbo making a run in the center. Adelino, who's the sweeper for Fiorentina and was outstanding against Milan, as indeed were all their defenders. It was an exhilarating 2-2 draw, and I think on that day Fiorentina really came of age, certainly underlined their championship credentials. Toldo, who's in the frame now with the Italian national team, hoping to claim a place for the European Championship finals, but I would think he's just behind certainly Luca Bucci and Peruzzi of Juventus. This is Carnesciali back in the Fiorentina side today after suspension, and he had been doubtful through injury, and we thought maybe Robbiati would play, but he's on the bench. Carnesciali restored to the starting lineup, playing at left back instead of his normal position on the right. This is Capioli, a forceful run that's curtailed by Serena, former Sampdoria player. Totti seemed to be hauled down there. Francesco Totti, former youth team product, who's come up through the system with Roma, made his debut for the club in Serie A at the age of 16. Really highly rated young player. And he's just won his place in the Italian under-21 setup too. Capped just before Christmas. The cross and the flick almost from Capioli, and it's there from Belbo. It's a goal. Just 4.5 minutes gone. Abel Belbo has scored for Roma.
Well, it's a work to, it's a training ground free kick. Fonseca with that left foot to swing it in on that near post. A little board to open the angle and then right into that near post. And obviously everybody's getting in there, following everything up as forwards do. And Balbo gets on the end of it and sticks it in.
Mazzoni is such an experienced coach, 28 years in the business. And his former clubs include Fiorentina. He took them into Europe back in the mid-70s. Ranieri, the coach of Fiorentina, who says he'll quit if his team don't get into Europe come the end of the campaign. Balbo now looking to threaten Fiorentina again. And looking very lively with his three-pronged attack, Balbo, Fonseca, and also Totti.
Yeah, he's a young boy who's just... He's got himself in the side over the last couple of years. He doesn't get in the side every week, Peter, but they bring him in every now and again. They give him experience, and he'll keep going on down that right flank.
Fonseca's cross, Aldair at the far post. And the tall figure of Toldo was nowhere near that one. He's around 6'6", but he misjudged it totally, and Aldair was left unmarked at the far post. But here's Battistuta now on the break for Fiorentina. Tackled by Turn, or was it? No, it was late.
No, I don't think he got his foot to the ball, Josef Turn. He's trying to get back, and he's catching up Battistuta. But when he made his challenge, really on the way back, he only catches Battistuta's legs.
Rui Costa. Carnachali, again supporting down that right side. Off Aldair, the Brazilian. Mujica. Won't fall for Baiano, but it will for Serena. Good strike too, and Cervone almost lost it then in flight. It squirmed away from him. Well, perhaps he didn't get a good view of it, I don't know, but he won't be too pleased with his goalkeeping there.
Did well there, Serena. Came from nowhere to get his shot in. The goalkeeper made a right mess of it.
Serena now with the cross. Away by Balbo. There's nobody upfield for Roma. Bajica. Battistuta is offside. The Roma backline have pushed a long way forward. There's a shot again from Serena. A greasy ball. And Cervone couldn't hold it. Offside against Fonseca. And these offside decisions rather stopping the flow of the game.
Yeah, and the crowd again very frustrated by it. But I've got to say this. From our position, they definitely do look offside. I mean, there's not much doubt about it. It's just the timing of the run from the front players.
This is Carnachali, away from Statuto. The Piacentini, Mujica. Rui Costa, held back there, though, by Di Biagio. They really need him to be more influential, Rui Costa. Offside again, is it? No, I don't think the flag was... No, Baiano was offside this time. So he timed his run to perfection. And that was a real escape then for Roma. Baiano on the end of that chip through. Roma defenders looking in vain for an offside flag.
No, the linesman didn't give that, Peter.
Fonseca with Balbo. Away from Paterino, good play then by Balbo. Until he was confronted by Bajica. Fiorentina working diligently to win the ball back again. Serena. Only as far as Capioli. This is Totti. Capioli again. Balbo. Di Biagio. Solid tackle by Serena. Now Schwarz. It's all got very untidy at the moment.
Well, that was just a nasty tackle by Schwarz. He's knocked it too far forward, and then he virtually goes over the top.
I mean, that's... Swedish teammate turned too.
Yeah. I mean, that's at least a yellow card. He's miscontrolled the ball. He's on his way forward, Schwarz, and he's knocked it too far forward. So now he goes over the top to the challenging player, Jonas Tern.
Di Biagio was caught out there. Play on, says the referee, but Schwarz to Rui Costa. Batistuta is through here. This is Batistuta! He seemed to have done the hard part, chipped the goalkeeper so delicately, and it's just past the far post.
Top-class football. Keeper comes out, lifts it over him, just misses the goal. A lovely move. Here again, Rui Costa involved. Picks the ball up, middle of the Roma half. Batistuta there, pulls away to his right-hand side, and he just threads it outside, just outside the defenders. He lifts it over to the keeper there, and he's just outside that far post.
On by Batistuta. Rui Costa, he's got Schwarz up with him. Trying to slip it through. Just too many defenders in the end for him. Including the tough tackling Petruzzi, who's arguing the point now with Rui Costa. The referee having to step in to calm things down. Then Di Biagio foolishly getting involved. And this is all getting out of hand.
Well, it's definitely been on the cards, this, Peter. And it's amazing how it starts off, because Rui Costa was trying to get back to Petruzzi, and it's a bit of a challenge, and it was a foul, but nothing really harsh, and off he goes. Petruzzi picks himself up, bangs into Rui Costa, then all the other players come and get involved. It's a difficult job for a referee under those circumstances.
Turn. Aldair. We've had 2 minutes now of injury time. It'll slip then by Maruso, which hasn't proved too costly. Away by Serena. Then Batistuta. Rui Costa. On goes Batistuta, but Petruzzi is there. Again, very tidy and composed at the back. Totti. Good turn by Di Biagio. He's got Statuto in some space now. Options in the middle. Oh, Statuto clearly wanted to cut inside on his right foot, and Stefan Schwarz prevented him from doing so.
Yeah, but it does make a meal of this one. I mean, he catches him. I mean, he bumps into him, Stefan Schwarz, but it's not as hard as what that one looks.
I think Schwarz rather knew where he was going, but couldn't actually stop him legally. So Mazzoni with plenty to think over before giving his half-time team talk, if half-time ever comes. So a late chance in the first half. It'll be Abel Balbo. It spins away for a corner. Not quite sure where all this injury time has come from. There was Batistuta's problem. One or two other minor ailments. Totti with the corner. Garnaccioli didn't get to it, and Noni did. But thankfully, from Fiorentina's point of view, Toldo was back on his goal line. And that is the final whistle now from the first half, blown by referee Boschi. Bit of an untidy first 45 minutes, really. Just the one goal scored inside the first 5 minutes by Abel Balbo for Roma. But they rather went back on the defensive from there on, played on the break, and Fiorentina found them hard to break down. That one real chance that Batistuta steered wide. Fiorentina have brought on Robbiati for the start of the second half. There were certainly a few raised eyebrows that he wasn't in right from the start. He had been playing so well. And he's come on for Bajica for this second period. So the change being made by Ranieri. Robbiati, who scored the first goal in that 2-2 draw with Milan, Fiorentina's last outing. Bajano with the second goal. It certainly showed their character that afternoon in coming back twice from behind. Fiorentina played very impressively, and they'll be hoping for more of the same in the second half in this game. Here's Totti for Roma, hauled back though by his former teammate Piacentini, and a yellow card for the ex-Roma man.
He's just grabbed hold of him as he's gone past him. I mean, the referee's dead right. He's just grabbed hold of his shirt.
Here's Statuto taking the free kick. Fisted away by Toldo, back in by Turn. Offside against Abel Balbo. And again, a bit of a dangerous game that Fiorentina were playing there. But they have got away with it. Balbo, whose goal divides the two teams, scored with just 4 minutes on the clock. It all went rather downhill from there, disappointingly, in the first period. Padolino. Rui Costa. Aldair, the covering defender. And a magnificent first half, Aldair. Then Piacentini in quickly on Jonas Turn. Playing his sixth game in a row today, that's his best for Roma. He's had a lot of injury problems since moving from Napoli. His fourth season now in Italy, and he's only scored twice. Poor return for normally such inventive and attacking player. Padolino. Easily away by Aldair, here's Balbo, Fonseca alongside him. Fonseca away from Padolino's tackle, and Balbo makes it two! And Roma have started the second half as they opened the first one. Abel Balbo with his second of the game, and that one was conjured up in South America.
Now that's what we talk composure. And he's done it ever so well, Fonseca. He's picked the ball up on this left-hand side of the box, goes past that last defender, keeps his head, he knows he's on a difficult angle, pulls it square across the six-yard box, in comes Balbo, little touch, it's in the net.
Sizzling pace then by Fonseca, and unselfishly into the path of Balbo for a clinical finish. 51 minutes gone. 2-0 to Roma, and it's 2 for Abel Balbo.
That's terrific understanding by a front pair of strikers, you know. You talk about balance and understanding and knowing each other's game. I mean, the move really was sorted out between the two of them all the way through until it was touched into the net.
There's no doubt they're such a formidable combination when they are both on song. Way now by the other South American, Aldair to Statuto. Fonseca's touch. Turns giving it away to Rui Costa. Can Fiorentina raise their game again in this second half?
He keeps getting caught on the ball every now and again, Rui Costa. At times you think he's overrunning the ball, but I think that's the front players. I don't think Batistuta and Baiano are doing anything today, Peter. And I think he's looking for them to make a move, and he's having to take the ball farther on than really what he wants to.
That's Schwartz, but no real power behind the shot from the Swedish international. Second now, waiting again for Roma, swimming it through and almost into the path of Balbo. He looks so dangerous, Fonseca, when he sets off on those
brilliant runs. Peter, what he does, he just pulls out to the flanks. He pulls away from the marking in the middle of the pitch. And he finds himself some room out on the flanks, and from there, he runs at defenders.
Well, Fiorentina have to commit defenders now at the other end. Rui Costa can't thread it through, Petruzzi is there. Another superb game from Petruzzi. And he's made a rare excursion upfield now. Fonseca, Balbo inside him. Fonseca again. Still the Uruguayan. Trying to chip it through. Balbo! That would have been some way to complete a hat-trick. Wonderful approach play again from Roma and Fonseca in particular.
Well, he's having a wonderful second half. I mean, he didn't roll the first half, but the second half. And he keeps running on that left foot and cutting inside players and finding himself a bit more space.
Thrilling football by Roma. Di Biagio. And that is not even going to hit the corner flag. It was that far wide. Took a deflection there, which very nearly deceived Toldo. And then the audacity of Balbo so nearly produced a goal.
Yeah, that it just took a little bit of the pace off the shot, the deflection.
Balbo! Now Totti! Fiorentina at the moment are in disarray. Totti with the chance. Yeah, Totti with the miss.
Peter, the young boy knows he should have scored here. I mean, you're not going to get many chances like that 12 yards out with only the goalkeeper to beat.
Schwarz on for Rui Costa. Baiano away to his left. Now, could he service Batistuta in the middle, or maybe Schwarz? No, it's off Jonas Turn. Amoruso. Piacentini, down goes Batistuta, and he's convinced the referee that was a foul. I'm not so sure. An hour gone, and the free kick conceded by Aldair.
Where Aldair went searching for it. He virtually put his foot between Batistuta's legs. He went searching for the ball, hoping, feeling for the ball. That's the way you give fouls away.
So an opportunity for Fiorentina.
Dangerous spot.
Yeah, Rui Costa hovering, Robbie Arte. Batistuta presumably not fancying this one. He's now arguing with the referee. Here is Robbie Arte. Oh! What a strike by Robbie Arte. And Fiorentina are back in contention. The substitution has paid off. Robbie Arte for Fiorentina.
Well, there we are. You give free kicks away on the edge of your D, you're in trouble. And he's curled that one nicely up into the top corner. No chance for the goalkeeper. None at all. It'll bend over the inside of the wall and go away from the goalkeeper just inside that post. No chance for the goalkeeper.
Here's Carnacioli, one of the many internationals on view. Piacentini, Batistuta to Carnacioli. The rain falling really heavily now, so conditions ever worsening. That's Anoni with a header out. Jonas Turn. Straight to Amoruso. Carnacioli. Batistuta calling in the middle. Aldair. Composed defending by Roma. Statuto to Fonseca. Now Turn. Fonseca again. Releasing Statuto. Offside.
He's that man again, Peter.
He's a busy man this afternoon, as the linesman over on that far side. Not the most popular man with the Roma fans, and certainly not with the coach Mazzoni. Rui Costa. Careless work then by Aldair, of all people. Robbie Arte on for Rui Costa. It'll drag back then towards Padolino, who come forward, and it was Petruzzi in collision with him, the other sweeper. 20 minutes to go. Corner to Fiorentina, which Robbie Arte will take. Batistuta hoping in the middle. It was a free header and a goal for Batistuta. Somehow he totally escaped the marking. Nobody picked him up. And Batistuta has scored his 11th goal in Serie A this season to make it 2-2 on 71 minutes.
Well, it's a good header, but genius. I mean, how can you be from a corner, the centre forward, and you can be on the back post unmarked? That's crazy. That's just, see, the discipline's gone up the back and they're not concentrating. And instead of sorting it out there when they gave the corner away, they haven't picked up the the centre forward. He comes in free at the back. He's not going to miss those.
Giovanni didn't have too much to do in the first half, but he's been beaten twice now for this stunning comeback by Fiorentina. Just under 15 minutes remaining. Padolino happy for Toldo to collect it. The tallest goalkeeper in Serie A at 6'6". Toldo. Schiavone's no midget at the other end. Serena now. Off Aldair. Mariano to Rui Costa. Now Robbiati. Certainly does add some variety to Fiorentina's attacking play, but not on the same wavelength then as Carnesciani.
What they're doing now, Roma, is they're dropping off. I mean, they're giving the Fiorentina midfield a lot of space to pick out their forward passes. Now, Turn and Di Baggio, really, they should be now doing a lot more pressing and closing down.
Del Vecchio is on for Luigi Di Baggio.
I'm not surprised about that. The lad had gone. Di Baggio had definitely gone.
Rui Costa slipping it through. Batistuta making a nuisance of himself with Anoni. Such determination shown then by the Argentine international. He's in trouble, and so is Anoni. Some niggling going on there between defender and attacker. Well, Batistuta is going to have to come off. Coes will now take his place. Anoni. That's off Serena for Moriero. Goes Capioli! And again, if that had spilled away from Toldo, Balbo and Fonseca were there. It was a strong header by Capioli.
Yeah, and it was a free header. I mean, they let the cross come in. There's no closing down on the player crossing the ball into the box. And there's a free header virtually on the penalty spot.
Piacentini, that's off Statuto, off his body, not his arm. Del Vecchio. Gave Carnesciani a chasing then, and Amoruso conceding the corner, maybe felt Toldo should have come out to collect.
Yeah, but that's what he's got to do. He gets down this left flank, Del Vecchio, just got to get across the edge of that six-yard box. He's got enough players who'll get on the end of it, they'll try and get there.
Fonseca with the corner. Toldo thought about coming for it, and just got back in time from Balbo's header. Cursing his misfortune then, Abel Balbo.
It's at both ends. There's just no marking. I mean, there's two queuing up on the back post. Tony's in there with Balbo.
Well, Toldo was clearly caught in two minds. He started to come for the cross, checked back, and he was in the right place at the right time. Yeah. Obviously, the ball is very slippery now. Stefan Schwarz, hopefully forward. Petruzzi knowing that Giovone was behind him. Here is Petruzzi again. Roma will consider themselves very unlucky not to have won it right at the death. But overall, that's a bit harsh on Fiorentina. Fonseca now. He's kept it in play too. Swinging over the cross, Toldo to beat it away. Driven back in by Jonas Turn. Capioli surely offside. A speculative drive by Jonas Turn, who got his first goal for Roma in their recent game against Napoli, his old club.
Yeah, but in these conditions, like you said, anything can happen. I mean, a little ricochet there. Not easy for the goalkeeper. He did well to get out there, Toldo.
Away from Moriero, in goes Capioli. This is Baiano, linking with Robbiati. And no chance of Serena getting to that one. Roma looking now to stage a grandstand finale. They might get it too. Del Vecchio taking on Carnesciale, who's blocked it well. I think that was over the line for a corner. It was.
Terrific defending there from Carnesciale. Well-timed sliding tackle.
Fonseca in the driving rain. Curling it over. And over the top from Abel Balbo, to the relief of Fiorentina.
Well, the corner just goes to the back post. And once more, there's Annone and Balbo once more on the back post. No one marking.
I think there was a bit of pushing anyway. Well, it's been in the end a hard-earned point then, if it stays this way for Fiorentina. There seemed to be no way back for them once they got two down. But all credit to them for the manner of their recovery. Carnesciale taking the throw. Baiano. Free kick to Fiorentina for the offence on Baiano. Piacentini taking charge of the situation with Robbiati alongside him. That's Padolino. An offside decision against Fiorentina, but surely no time left now for Roma to snatch a winner. That's Jano's turn. Fiorentina with arms aloft to signal that they have indeed taken a point here in the Olympic Stadium. A 2-2 draw. They've come back so well, having been two down. The double strike from Abel Balbo, the goals from Robbiati and from Battistuta make it 2-2, the final score in Rome.
So all square at the Stadio Olimpico. Meanwhile at the San Siro, Milan played host to Sampdoria. Here's Gary Bloom.
George Weah's had more to celebrate than most over Christmas. He's been named as the winner of the Golden Ball, the European Footballer of the Year. He adds that accolade to his African Footballer of the Year title. Weah plays his final game for Milan today before flying to South Africa to represent Liberia at the African Nations Cup. So it's Robbie Badger with a free kick. This is Albertini. Oh, good stop by the Sampdoria goalkeeper, Sereni. That ball bent and swerved on its way through to goal. So Badger to take it. Desai waiting inside the box. Weah, Panucci! And Milan have the lead. I wonder whether the header by George Weah was on target before it was met by Christian Panucci, who's made quite a reputation of scoring headed goals from set pieces. Weah's flick on was vital here, and it landed plumb in the path of Panucci. So Milan lead by goal to nil. Will it be Savicevic or Roberto Baggio to take the free kick? It's Baggio. Oh, and it's mighty close. I think the ball just kissed the outside of the upright. Badger desperately close to making it two. Desai, the French international, picking out Maldini. Savicevic. Oh, and Sampdoria could be in trouble here. Maldini dives in. The ball is out of play. But the wet conditions proved a real headache for Sampdoria there. The ball hit a puddle. And Maldini hits Sereni in the goal. Manini. Seedorf. The ball has run to Savicevic. He's round Manini and round the goalkeeper. Savicevic had to beat the wet conditions and the Sampdoria defence in converting this chance. The referee allowed the advantage there, but the ball hit a puddle inside the Sampdoria penalty area to make life very difficult indeed for Savicevic. The conditions didn't bother him, and Milan lead 2-0. So Mihailovic, presumably to strike the free kick, and it's beaten away by Rossi. He had to make a good stop there, and the ball bounced in front of him after it had left the boot of Mihailovic. This wasn't the easiest of saves. Rossi made it look easy. Savicevic. Baggio, lovely back heel. Savicevic, Lentini. Wonderful football by Milan in difficult conditions. The opening made by that extravagant back heel by Robbie Baggio. Lentini just unable to finish the move. Costa Curta. Appears to be injured. The referee's allowed the advantage. It's Baggio against Baleri. He's round Baleri, round Sacchetti. It's a marvellous goal by Roberto Baggio. And while the Sampdoria players were looking to the referee and expecting him to blow for a foul and a free kick to Milan, Robbie Baggio took full advantage of the advantage and scores Milan's third goal of the game. Savicevic. Sorese has injured himself making that challenge. Weah. And this is Donadoni. And the substitute almost makes it four. Good run by Savicevic. And then picked out George Weah. Weah's accurate ball picked out number 11, Donadoni. Defember. And support from Seedorf here. Oh, wonderful save by Rossi. It's easily Sampdoria's most incisive attack of the game. Seedorf drew a marvellous save out of Rossi. Remains 3-0.
So Milan start the year with a tremendous victory. Elsewhere, Roy Hodgson's Inter made the long journey south to Bari in the evening clash, while third-place Parma visited Torino and free-scoring Lazio made the trip to Napoli. But we start our roundup with the champions, Juventus. They travelled to Bergamo to take on Atalanta. Here's Gary Bloom.
Juventus were keen to avenge their Italian cap defeat against Atalanta and almost opened the scoring through Pesotto early on. The Ekevod was then denied by an instinctive save from Ferron, and Atalanta somehow managed to clear the danger. The ball appeared to strike the goalkeeper in the face, and the Ekevod was denied his first ever goal for Juventus. Atalanta's best effort in the first half fell to their talented youngster Morfeo, whose clever chip failed to deceive Peruzzi. Juventus started the second half brightly. Viali and Torricelli combined to set up Ravanelli, who brought the best out of Ferron. The turning point for the champions arrived with almost an hour gone. Montero appeared to have pushed Conte, and the referee awarded the Turin Giants a penalty. The Uruguayan's arm was certainly high, and the spot kick might have even been given for handball. Ferron braced himself for Ravanelli's attempt to score from 12 yards, but could do little to stop Juventus from taking the lead. Ravanelli's reaction underlined the importance of that goal to Juventus, who hadn't won away in Serie A for 4 months. And life was made easier for them when Tavolieri was booked for diving under Ferrara's challenge. It was the striker's second caution, and Atalanta will have to play the last 10 minutes or so with 10 men. Christian Vieri was playing his first game in 3 months after injury. The under-21 international still needs some time to rediscover his goal touch. Mondonico was powerless to alter the outcome of this game as Atalanta went down to their fourth straight league defeat. It ended 1-0 to Juventus. The new year started unhappily for Giovanni Trapattoni and his Canary side. The Sardinians put on a less than impressive display against Serie A's bottom club. A misdirected cross by Bissoli was the closest Canary came to scoring. Padova were far more convincing up front. Canary went into the half-time break on level terms thanks to their goalkeeper Valerio Fiori. He denied firstly Amoruso and then Longhi. Fiori got his positioning right to thwart Padova for a third time here. Amoruso again failed to score what would have been his seventh goal of the season. Padova had only ever managed one league win in Canary, and it came in Serie B 65 years ago. Stand by for a quality goal by Creek, which earned Padova their first away win of the season. It arrived with just 5 minutes left of the game. Napoli were hoping to win their first game since October. Had Beppe Signori scored with this free kick, Napoli's task would have been made that much harder. Lazio were seeking their first away victory in Serie A in 4 months. Alan Boksic was seeking his second goal of the season, but without success. Napoli have struggled to score goals this season. Andre Cruz hasn't managed one since the opening day. Of course, Lazio's main strength lies up front. They're the leading scorers in Serie A, but they've claimed just 5 of their 30 goals in away matches so far. Telly Lautella save from Vinter here. Arturo Di Napoli scored his first Serie A goal last time out for Napoli against Sampdoria, having come on as a substitute. He started his first Serie A game against Lazio and scored again. The home side were ahead on 24 minutes. They held a numerical advantage over Lazio too shortly before half-time. Alan Boksic lashed out at Roberto Bourdin and he was dismissed. Boksic's last sending off resulted from a dispute with Bourdin too. Roberto Policano's always had something of a hard man reputation, but how about this for finesse from the unpredictable Napoli player? There were no more goals in this game, but there was another sending off. Tarantino received his second caution and was awarded the red card. Lazio suffered their fourth straight away defeat in Serie A. Despite Pecchia's miss late on, Napoli still earned their first home win since the end of September. It's been more than 20 years since Piacenza last beat Udinese at home. After 13 minutes of this game, they were facing another defeat. Oliver Bierhoff claimed his 10th Serie A goal in this campaign to set his side on course for their first away win of the season. Carini came close to an equaliser, but not close enough. Battistini in Udinese's goal was having an inspired afternoon. He kept Udinese ahead again here, saving from Moretti and then half a dozen more players. Most of the danger during the rest of the match came via free kicks. Taibbi save, but almost gifted Amitrano a goal. And at the other end, Battistini was showing the Piacenza keeper how it should be done. And from another set piece, Udinese secured maximum points. This time the ball was curled to the back post, where Matricano was able to score only his second ever Serie A goal. I don't think he could quite believe it. He hadn't scored for 3 years. Parma had won on their last two visits to play Torino. They should have gone ahead early on after Di Chiara's forceful run, but Melli's finishing left a lot to be desired. However, Parma did take the lead 26 minutes in. Nesta Sensini was left unmarked to score for the first time this season. Torino's equaliser arrived just before half-time, while Parma's players stood and admired the home side's approach play. Dionigi directed his header past Bucci, who was back in the side after missing the last 2 months through injury. Needless to say, the goal meant a lot to the young striker. It was his first in Serie A for Torino. Parma regained their lead midway through the second half. The former Torino defender, Roberto Mussi, who made the first goal for Sensini, created the second one too. This time Dino Baggio, another former Torino player, got his name on the score sheet. Torino were in danger of losing for the first time under new coach Franco Scoglio. Here they claimed a penalty following Vicchiara's challenge on Dionigi. The spot kick wasn't given and Cristallini's frustration boiled over. His cynical foul on Sensini quite rightly resulted in a sending off for the midfielder, his second this season. Despite being a man down, Torino still managed to claim a point from this fixture thanks to Jocelyn Anglomar. Parma will see it as 2 points dropped. Vicenza and Cremonese met in Serie A for the very first time. A rare occasion gave rise to a rare occurrence. The home side opted for away colours. Mondini saved Vicenza's blushes from the free kick. And from the corner kick, Vicenza were unfortunate not to take the lead. Turchi save from Maini. But by far the best chance of the first half fell to Cremonese's Slovenian striker Matias Floriancic. Sadly for him, he failed to take it. Cremonese had won just 1 point on their travels. Judging by their finishing, it's easy to see why. Their one draw away from home this season ended goalless. This match didn't. With 70 minutes to go, Otero headed Vicenza's winner to take his tally to 6 for the season. It brightened a miserable afternoon for the home fans. And once Floriancic struck his shot wide, they were left to savour 3 valuable points. Roberto Carlos has one of the most lethal left-foot shots in the game. It must have come as something as a shock to Bari when the Brazilian opened the scoring for Inter with a stunning effort via his right boot. Bari settled down once they'd drawn level, courtesy of some poor defending. Luigi Sala claimed his first goal in the top flight. It got worse for Inter, much worse in fact. Bergami was sent off with 20 minutes left and Igor Proti put Bari ahead shortly afterwards. The home side then made it 3-1. Klaus Ingerson, signed from Sheffield Wednesday in November, scored his first goal for the club. And in stoppage time, Bari secured a famous victory with strike number 4. Anderson deserved the goal. Proti claimed it to take his tally to 12. There was one consolation for Paul Ince. He missed the game through suspension. It ended 4-1 to Bari. Milan have extended their lead at the top. They now lead Fiorentina by 3 points. Parma is still third, while the champions Juventus are back in the title race following their win in Bergamo. Lazio and Roma are locked together on equal points. Atalanta, Inter and Sampdoria have all dropped into the bottom half of the table following defeats in week 16. The next half a dozen clubs still have hopes of avoiding the drop. Only Piacenza and Cremonese, who are now bottom, lost at the weekend. Igor Proti has reclaimed sole leadership at the top of the scorers' charts after scoring twice against Inter. He's now on 12. Battistuta and Bierhoff both up their totals to keep the pressure on the Bari striker. And we leave you with Milan, who said goodbye to European Footballer of the Year, George Weah, who's off to the African Nations Cup in South Africa. Mind you, even without Weah, Milan still have one or two useful goal scorers.
We know what's going on there. What's happening there isn't good. I'm happy that I can take part in such an event, that I can help. Not only myself, but all the other players who took up the invitation will also help my country, as well as other countries where children have nothing to eat and have no homes.
Returning heroes like Hristo Stoichkov were greeted like old friends. He donated the Golden Ball, his prize for being European Player of the Year, to the Barcelona club and supporters. Most of the players had played here before, in the case of American Alexi Lalas, at the 1992 Olympics.
Obviously, my life's changed a tremendous amount. So as far as coming full circle, it's incredible where I am now and where I was then. I mean, back in the Olympic Games, I was just, you know, hoping to get through the Olympics and maybe someone will see me, maybe I'll get a chance to play. And now everywhere I go in the world, you know, people know who I am.
The match, Europe against the Americas, was broadcast to 60 countries. Romario turned on the style in his first game back at the Nou Camp since leaving Barcelona under a cloud. For 37 minutes, Europe were forced to defend. But Romario was irrepressible. The Argentine Latorre, the scorer. No match of this kind would be complete without the characteristic antics of Colombia's flamboyant goalkeeper, René Higuita. But his over-elaboration gave Real Madrid's Michel the opportunity to make Higuita pay for his eccentricity. America's coach, César Luis Menotti, could afford to smile. There were no points at stake, but there was real purpose. 50,000 spectators donated 50 million pesetas as they warmed to the prospect of the second half and a new cast of star performers. There are almost enough famous names wanting to play to make up another side. Mexico's Jorge Campos was only too happy to make the journey across the Atlantic to appear for 45 minutes.
Well, it's a long way on the map, but not in our minds. It's very close to us. We would never want this to happen to our country or anywhere else in the world.
Before the second half got underway, old friends had a quick chance to exchange some thoughts. But it was still Romario's show. Stoichkov beat Campos from close range to pull one back for Europe. But Romario had obviously decided to show his former coach what might have been. After Higuita, more goalkeeping showmanship from Campos. And then from his Mexican colleague, striker Hugo Sanchez. Crown a glittering performance on his Barcelona return, Romario completed his hat-trick in style. Arteaga of Spain scored Europe's second. Romario left the scene to a huge ovation. Europe pulled another goal back and almost equalised when Bernd Schuster of Germany went so close. Three, the final score, but a night when everyone was a winner. UNICEF and Bosnian children, the main beneficiaries of the superstar's contribution.
I think the footballers have always offered to help whenever asked. Sometimes they were wrongly exploited, but that wasn't the footballers' fault, but their bosses, who don't contribute to the worthy causes of such a popular sport, so deeply rooted in the people. But every time the footballer is asked to take part for such a good cause as this, he'll always say yes.
Sadly, Mayor Codro could not play. He was sidelined through injury, but the occasion and its significance was no less rewarding.
Certainly, it means a lot for the players. A lot for me personally. Maybe because my compatriots and I have experienced such problems personally. For me, it means a lot to fight for peace and the welfare of threatened people.
A night to remember in Barcelona, heightening expectations that the now fragile peace will hold in Bosnia.
And
Juventus-Bari è stata una partita piacevole, niente di eccezionale, intendiamoci, ma senza dubbio godibile. se non altro per il continuo mutare delle situazioni. È stato come vedere un film con Schwarzenegger, contenuti pochi, ma sugli effetti speciali niente da dire. Come la punizione di Del Piero, che Fontana riesce a cacciar fuori dalla porta poco prima che varchi la linea, o dopo averla varcata. Ma al nono minuto l'effetto è davvero speciale, quando il Bari passa in vantaggio. Contropiede di Gautieri sulla sinistra, gran cross del numero 7, dalla parte opposta le scarpette rosse di Igor Protti infilzano una retroguardia bianconera alquanto statica. In avanti le cose per la Juve non è che vadano molto meglio, Ravanelli è poco dinamico e oltretutto Sala non gli dà respiro. Anche Vialli è soffocato da Mangone, mentre il fronte avanzato del Bari è attivissimo. Anderson e Protti si scambiano spesso posizione, favorendo oltretutto l'azione di Gautieri e Ingesson. Dopo che Protti si fa parare da Peruzzi, il possibile raddoppio, il pubblico juventino fischia sonoramente i bianconeri. Torricelli è pressoché innocuo. Ferrara un tantino più pericoloso. Ma mai quanto Ingesson, che di testa obbliga Paolo Sosa a salvare sulla linea in collaborazione con Peruzzi. Al 38esimo colpo di scena, Protti va via in contropiede e solo e da dietro Bjerkov lo mette giù. Nessun dubbio per Calbuto, che espelle il vecchio Pietro. La Juve è in 10, ma riesce ad agguantare il pari. C'è un contrasto in area barese fra Ingesson e Conte e l'arbitro fischia subito il rigore. Ravanelli scarica il pallone sotto la traversa. Vialli non si vede e allora Del Piero tenta il numero preferito di Gianluca, la rovesciata. Ma su questo gesto tecnico deve ancora studiare molto Alex.
Alessandro Del Piero, attaccante. 26 assist in campionato, 33 conclusioni, 16 tiri in porta, 3 reti.
Nella ripresa Lippi inserisce Di Livio e toglie Ravanelli. Paolo Sosa arretra leggermente, mentre Ferrara si concede qualche sortita in più, anche perché è dotato di un buon colpo di testa. Ma è il Bari a graffiare. Gautieri da destra favorisce la deviazione aerea di Anderson e Peruzzi per salvarsi. Deve mettere qualche falange di prolunga alle sue dita. Le occasioni si fanno più rare, ma quello che colpisce è la tranquillità e l'autorevolezza del Bari nel disimpegno e nel contropiede. Le cose migliori accadono nel finale, un gran tiro di Di Livio parato da Fontana, una traversa di Ferrara dopo un bel colpo di testa, ma soprattutto un numero di alta classe di Parente che appena entrato delizia la platea con un affondo che mette in fibrillazione Peruzzi e Delle Alpi.
Piero Parente, centrocampista. 270 palle giocate in campionato, 64 palle recuperate, 44 passaggi utili, 4 assist.
Poi ci prova ancora Protti. Il suo è un tiro cross, passa non più di un metro da Parente e si perde al lato. Il pareggio del Bari non fa una grinza.
Sono partite dove squadre come il Bari faranno sempre bella figura, perché non hanno niente da perdere, entrano in campo senza nessuna pressione e poi hanno la fortuna anche di andare in vantaggio e allora diventa tutto facile dopo. Voglio vedere questo Bari quando incontreremo squadre della nostra forza che dovrà fare la partita.
Giochiamo in questa maniera, a fine stagione hanno ragione se dicono andatevene tutti a casa e cambiamo allenatore e giocatori, hanno perfettamente ragione se continuiamo a giocare così.
Enrico Chiesa, attaccante. 6 assist in campionato, 25 conclusioni, 15 tiri in porta, 9 reti.
Vicenza accusa ma non demorde, mentre uno sparuto gruppo di esagitati tifosi vicentini ingaggia un corpo a corpo con le forze dell'ordine. Frattanto in campo è ancora la Samp a creare le azioni più pericolose. Qui è Seedorf, servito da Invernizzi al 25esimo a sfiorare il 7. Ma il Vicenza insiste. Qui è Rossi al 33esimo a costringere Sereni ad un bel intervento, ma 4 minuti dopo la Samp raddoppia con una bella incornata di Carambeu su angolo battuto da Mihajlovic. Sembra fatta, ma dopo soli 2 minuti il Vicenza dimezza lo svantaggio. Murgita serve Rossi, uno degli uomini più attivi della squadra veneta, che di testa anticipa Sereni.
99 su 100 si dà il fallo, invece non mi hanno aiutato proprio un po' il debutto a Marassi, un po' così. La sfortuna non è stata.
Nella ripresa Eriksson sostituisce Mannini con Sacchetti, ma il Vicenza preme alla ricerca del pareggio e Sereni, colpevole solo nell'azione del gol, ammaestrato dall'esperienza precedente, questa volta si esibisce in una serie di interventi di pugno. La partita si mantiene piacevole con continui rovesciamenti di fronte. Guidolin sostituisce Lombardi con Ambrosetti, avanzando il baricentro vicentino ed esponendosi così ai contrattacchi bulcerchiati. Qui Mondini vola a respingere una punizione di Mihajlovic e subito dopo Bellucci sciupa malamente un ottimo suggerimento di Seedorf. Ma tre minuti dopo è la traversa a salvare Sereni su tiro di Otero e al 29esimo proprio Ambrosetti, servito da Murgita, trafigge con un gran tiro Sereni. La reazione della Sampdoria è rabbiosa e Maniero, da poco subentrato a Bellucci, subisce una spinta in area di rigore, ma per l'arbitro Pellegrino ormai rien ne va plus. Nel finale poteva esserci forse un rigore oppure no?
Vedremo sempre, e voi in televisione che dovete dimostrare questo. Mi auguro di sì, perché se è così vinco un caffè. All'arbitro paga.
Siamo riusciti ad alzare il ritmo e quindi a mettere anche in difficoltà la Samp e a creare occasioni da gol. Per me è importante che le occasioni vengano create. Poi ho dei buoni giocatori che magari non subito, ma un po' alla volta riescono anche a concretizzare.
Eriksson abbia perso il caffè e quindi dovrà pagarlo all'arbitro, che in questo caso era Pellegrino. Guardiamo l'azione, ecco il cross, guardate in questo momento, sembra che ci sia una spinta da parte del difensore su Del Vicenza nei confronti dell'attaccante della Sampdoria. Ma se guardiamo attentamente, vediamo che il fallo ha inizio in questo momento, quindi è il difensore della Sampdoria a commettere fallo, ed ecco perché l'arbitro assegna un calcio di punizione in favore dei difendenti. Credo che abbia vinto
bene. Pellegrino non solo ha fatto bene, ha vinto pure un caffè. Alba, dove sei andato?
Io sono alla...
Goran Vlahovic raccoglie gli applausi del pubblico. Il croato sta diventando l'anima della difficile risalita del Padova. Da quando si è lasciato alle spalle la malattia, ha giocato 6 partite e realizzato 5 gol. Ed il Padova, con l'emozionante 3-2 di oggi, ha archiviato il secondo successo consecutivo. Periodo nero invece per Mondonico, quinta sconfitta di fila per la sua Atalanta, che presentava dal primo minuto la coppia d'attacco Vieri-Tovalieri. L'ex barese però non è apparso molto ispirato. Quella del 24esimo è una delle poche conclusioni di un primo tempo equilibrato, con le due squadre che hanno giocato a non farsi del male. Guardate ad esempio dove va a finire il colpo di testa di Vlahovic sul bel cross di Amoruso al 33esimo. 4 minuti dopo l'episodio che imprime una svolta alla partita. Luppi faccia Sconziano ed è espulso per doppia ammonizione. Atalanta in 10 e Padova in vantaggio al secondo minuto della ripresa. Amoruso costruisce l'assist per Van Utrecht. Il diagonale è teso e preciso. Pensate, l'olandese aveva preso il posto di Sconziano negli ultimi minuti del primo tempo. E questo è il suo primo gol in Serie A. Cambio azzeccato anche quello di Mondonico, che richiama Tovalieri e lancia Morfeo. Morfeo infatti sta giocando il suo 3° minuto di gara quando chiede il triangolo a Vieri e pareggia il conto al 10°. E al 21esimo il cross di Herrera è respinto da Quicchi, ma al sinistro ancora di Morfeo non lascia scampo a Bonaiuti e l'Atalanta è in vantaggio. 2-1, doppietta di Morfeo e 6° gol stagionale per il fantasista. A questo punto la reazione del Padova è decisa, di Bergamaschi accusano l'inferiorità numerica. Già al 29esimo sul cross di Gabrieli, nonostante la pessima uscita di Ferron, Vlahovic manca il gol da pochi centimetri, invocando un indecifrabile fallo di Herrera. Ma il croato impiega 1 minuto a farsi perdonare. Sul lungo lancio di Longhi approfitta dell'indecisione di Valentini e Ferron e pareggia. Poi, sul traversone di Quicchi, sfiorato da Amoruso, controlla con il sinistro e conclude di destro, regalando il successo per 3-2 a suo Padova.
Goran Vlahovic, attaccante. 5 assist in campionato, 11 conclusioni, 6 tiri in porta, 5 reti.
Noi abbiamo giocato molto bene in maniera ordinata al primo tempo e una volta ottenuto il vantaggio ci siamo un pochettino adagiati, abbiamo avuto un calo di tensione pericolosissimo, perché il nostro avversario è un avversario di grande levatura, soprattutto sotto l'aspetto della determinazione, uno dei migliori che noi abbiamo affrontato, e lì potevamo complicare.